I should now call an irresistible urge to do things not as others do. At that age, for example, I did such things as the following. When my brother, sisters, and the neighbor's children who came to play with us were learning to catch a ball only with the right hand, and threw it in the air, I would first bounce the ball hard on the ground, and when it rebounded, after first doing a somersault, would catch it, but only with the thumb and middle finger of the left hand. For if all the other children slid down the hill head first, I would try to do it, and moreover better and better each time, backside first, for if we were given various kinds of Abaramian pastries, and the others, before putting them into their mouths, would first of all lick them, evidently to try their flavor and prolong the pleasure, I would first sniff one on all sides and perhaps even put it to my ear and listen intently, and then, almost unconsciously, though very seriously, I would mutter to myself, enough is enough, you don't need me stuff. And coming to an appropriate rhythm, would swallow it whole without savoring it, and so on and so forth. The first event that gave rise to one of the two data I mentioned, which became the vivifying sources for nourishing and perfecting my deceased grandmother's injunction, occurred just at the age when I changed from a chubby mite into what is called a young rascal, and had already begun, as is sometimes said, to be a candidate for a young man of pleasing appearance and beauteous content. And this event occurred under the following circumstances, which were perhaps even specially combined by fate. One day, with a number of young rascals like myself, I was setting snares for pigeons on the roof of a neighbor's house, when suddenly one of the boys who was standing over me and watching me closely said, "I think the horsehair noose ought to be set so that the pigeon's big toe never gets caught in it because, as our zoology teacher recently explained to us, it is just in that toe that the pigeon's reserve strength is concentrated, and of course if this big toe gets caught in the noose, the pigeon might easily break it." Another boy, leaning over just opposite me, from whose mouth, by the way, whenever he spoke saliva always splashed abundantly in all directions, snapped at this remark of the first boy and delivered himself, with a copious shower of saliva, of the following words. "What an abortion you are, just like your teacher, even if it's true that the pigeon's greatest physical force is concentrated in its big toe, then all the more reason for seeing that just the toe gets caught in the noose only then can there be any importance for our aim, that is, catching these unfortunate pigeon creatures, in a certain particularity." Ridiculous to the point of absurdity. He discharge the last words with such a shower of saliva that it looked as if my face had been exposed to one of those atomizers, not a mere sauce production, invented by the Germans to spray material with aniline dyes. This was more than I could endure, and without changing my squatting position, I flung myself at him head first, hitting him full force in the pit of the stomach, which instantly laid him out flat and made him, as is said, lose consciousness. I do not know or wish to know what results will be formed in your mentation on learning about the strange convergence of life circumstances I will now describe, but for my mentation, this coincidence provided material for reinforcing my belief that all the events that occurred in my youth, far from being simply the result of chance, were created intentionally by certain extraneous forces. This dexterity had been taught me very thoroughly only a few days before the event by a Greek priest from Turkey, who, persecuted by the Turks for his political convictions, had been compelled to flee from there, and on arriving in our town had been engaged by my parents to teach me the modern Greek language. I do not know on what he based his political convictions and ideas, but I remember very well that in all our conversations, even when he was explaining the difference between ancient and modern Greek explanations, it was apparent that the Greek priest was always dreaming of getting to the island of Crete as soon as possible, and manifesting himself there as the physical patriot. Well then, on the whole, in the effect of my skill, I must confess, extremely frightened, because knowing nothing about such a reaction to a blow in that place, I was quite sure I had killed him. And while I was experiencing this fear, another boy, a cousin of the one who had become the first victim of my so-called skill in self-defense, seeing what I had done and obviously overcome by a feeling called consanguinity, without a moment's pause leapt at me and with a wide swing punched me in the jaw.